ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبي الرحمة والهدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and all his companions. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, it brings tears to the eyes in gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having granted us the acceptance to witness this blessed month. Tonight being the first night of the month of Ramadan, 1432 Hijri, 1432 years after the Hijrah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we are seated here in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, far away in the city of Cape Town, in this beautiful Masjid Zinatul Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept every single effort of ours. Every one of us who has made an effort to come here this evening, all the listeners, all the viewers, every single person, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all forgiveness. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lighten up our lives, just like we noticed the difference when these lights were put on. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in nur and to grant us the full use of this month of Ramadan. Really, it is a sacrifice, it is a month of sacrifice. It is a month where we will be abstaining from many things for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from a certain time to a certain time. And in the evenings we will be sacrificing again to stand in long prayer solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember, it is an effort that will make us from amongst those who are successful. Those who are not prepared to put an effort or to make an effort, what type of success do they expect? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our efforts. This evening, inshallah, I have decided to embark on a series known as Lessons from the Stories of the Prophets, may peace be upon them all, that are mentioned in the Quran. And as you know, it is very important to introduce a topic. So tonight will be dedicated to the introduction. And it is very important that we know what is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects from us. We all know that we were created by Allah. We were created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We call Him Rabbul Alameen. We call Him Lord of the Worlds. And the word Rabb does not have an English translation. It would require a whole paragraph for us to understand what is meant by it. And for this reason, some of the scholars have said the term Rabb includes the one who created, the one who nourishes, cherishes, provides for, protects, the one in absolute control of all the aspects of existence is known as Rabb. So this is why when we say Rabbun, we are referring to whoever made us and whoever is in absolute control. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. Before I commence, it is very important for me to make mention of the fact that each one of us would like to achieve the pleasure of the one who made us. And each one of us would like to achieve the paradise that he has prepared for us. But where did we come to learn about this paradise from? And where did we come to learn about the fact that there is life after death? We came to learn of it from the Creator himself. When he created us, he did not just leave us without giving us an instruction or a manual or sending us messengers to remind us. وَإِن مِّنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَى فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. Indeed, there is no nation that has passed except that there has been a messenger who was sent to that nation. A reminder, a warner. The word nadir in actual fact means a warner. One who warns to say, oh man, you are not in existence in order to enjoy your life. You are actually here as an examination and the qualification of that examination will determine your status in the real life, which is the life after death. And this is why all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were more interested in the life after death and in the hereafter than this dunya. None of them gave preference to this world. It's important for us to know this. And it's important also for us to know that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us and sent messengers and sent messages with those messengers, there were two types of people that He sent. One were those known as Rusul, and the others were known as Anbiya. There is a difference between a Rasul and a Nabi. So what is the difference? One is a messenger and one is a prophet. The one who has a higher status is a Rasul, a messenger. Because every messenger is a prophet, but not every prophet is a messenger. And here I'm using the English language, although I've used the word Rasul or the word messenger to refer to Rasul. What is meant by this? A Rasul is a person who came with a new Sharia, with some law, with a book, with something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him, an instruction, revelation, and Allah said, go and teach this to the people and go and warn them and so on. That is known as a Rasul. A person who is a messenger, given a message to go and deliver. And a Nabi, who is a prophet, is one who also delivered the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not given to him specifically, but rather given to some messenger who came before him. So this is why when we look at Harun alayhi salatu wa salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about him in the Quran, and Allah says, وَنَادَيْنَاهُ مِنْ جَانِبِ الطُّورِ الْأَيْمَنِ وَقَرَّبْنَاهُ نَجِيًّا وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ مِنْ رَحْمَتِنَا أَخَاهُ هَارُونَ نَبِيًّا. Allah speaks about Moses, may peace be upon him, Musa alayhi salam, and Allah says, we gave him, or we sent with him, Harun, or Aaron, may peace be upon him, as a Nabi, which means as a prophet, to help him. So whose message was it? It was the message of Allah. Given to whom? Given to Moses, may peace be upon him. But Harun alayhi salam was assisting. That is a very simple verse. If you'd like to know, you can memorize that verse, Harun nabiyan. If Harun alayhi salam was a Nabi, then it's automatically known that a Rasul is higher than a Nabi. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent two types of people. But there is a third type of person who is neither a Nabi nor a Rasul, but he is a Rasul of a Rasul, which means he is a messenger of a messenger. And who is that? Every single one of us. Subhanallah. We are all messengers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have the message, it is our duty to learn it, it is our duty to practice upon it, and it is our duty to teach it to others. This is why when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sending one of his companions, Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, to Yemen, and he asked him a few questions at the end of that, he says, Alhamdulillahi alladhi waffaqa Rasula Rasulillahi lima yarda Rasulullah. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has granted acceptance to the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to that which has pleased the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah guided Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obviously had sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in turn sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, and he has informed all of us, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Go and convey the message, even if it means a small verse. So every one of us, inshallah, we have that status. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us for that. Now, it is important for us to also go through the creation of man. Why Allah created us and how He created us, it is impossible to know that except through revelation. And this is what makes us believers. If you take a look at the Jewish scriptures or the Christian scriptures, the scriptures of the Muslims, you will find there are some similarities when it comes to the stories of the previous nations and how time began and how man was created and so on. But we adopt and we follow the Quran because we believe that there is a lot of rust that has crept into the previous scriptures. They are debating amongst themselves as to what is authentic, and there are so many different versions of the Bibles and the scriptures. that we have to discount them and we have to adopt what the Quran has said, because no doubt it is pure and it is pristine and there is no ways that anybody can argue with that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us acceptance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, and when He told us whatever He told us, He told that to us through revelation. So therefore, a person who is a non-believer or who does not believe in any of the heavenly religions, they would not know what happened. And if they were to tell you what happened, it means they got it from a heavenly scripture. No scientist can tell you that the first person created was created in this way and his name was Adam. And nobody can tell you that then there was Hawa and what happened. So we need to be Muslimin. We need to be submitters. We need to be mu'mineen, believers in the unseen. And we need to know that these scriptures that have come, they have come as a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us. Now if we take a look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed this book. And it is a very, very blessed book. And Allah has given us, the Muslims, a month known as Shahrul Quran. It is the month of the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept it the same month as the month of fasting. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about a night in this month that is so powerful. In it, the Quran was sent down from the preserved tablet to the lowest heaven. Allahu Akbar. And this is why he says, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. We have indeed revealed it in the night of decree. Laylatul Qadr translates as the night of taqdeer. The night of decree, when all that is going to happen for the next year is written by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is called Al-Qadr, the night of decree. We all call it the night of power because it also depicts the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is important for us to know that there is no doubt in the book that Allah has revealed. And as Muslims, we are fortunate to be from amongst those who follow a religion that makes it a duty upon us to study all the verses of the Quran, not just a few verses. And Allah says why He revealed the Quran. We need to know this. Why did Allah reveal the Quran? Why did He create man? Why did He do this? Why did He do that? The answers are in the Quran. This is why Allah says, Kitabun anzalnahu. It is a book that we have revealed. Ilayka, to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Mubarakun, it is so blessed. Liyadabbaru ayatih, in order for its verses to be pondered upon. So why did Allah reveal the Quran? In order for its verses to be pondered upon. That is the reason. So how many of us have pondered over the verses of the Quran? How many of us have understood why Allah revealed the Quran? Did He just reveal it that we can recite it? No point in understanding or no interest in understanding it? Did He reveal it so that we can use it as a pillow? We read it at night and then we put it away and go and sleep. And the following morning we get up? No. Take a look at what has happened to the Bible and to the other books. Very few followers of those books have read those books cover to cover. But every one of us have heard the Quran cover to cover by the will of Allah. This is why in the month of Ramadan, what are we doing? Great effort is required to prepare the Taraweeh, to come for the Taraweeh, to stand in the Taraweeh. It is not simple, it is not easy to be standing for 1 hour.